And there we go. How are you? How's everybody? Hey, let me give you a quick update on some stuff. Penny is having surgery today, this morning. So I want us to take a minute before we start and pray for her. So let's just do that right now, okay? Well, dear Heavenly Father, as she prepares for surgery this morning, we pray, Lord, that you would guide the doctors, that you would touch her body. Lord, we know that you're the healer. And so, Lord, we claim victory over this right now. Father, help her physically, but also help her in her spirit, because when you're in bed and you're hurting and you're like that, your spirits go down a little bit. So, Lord, surround her with people that are going to encourage her. In Jesus' name, amen. So I got a special message this morning from Ron up here in the front. See, he gave me something as a gift. It was a digital timer, and it will tell me when I'm talking too long. I think there's a message in that. Thanks, Ron. I appreciate that. I need to know that. And Sandy's doing that today, so thanks to Sandy. Hey, we're coming up on Thanksgiving. Can you believe that? Thursday? everyone's got their turkeys bought and all of that stuff, or okay, it's Thursday. I'm just telling you right now, so just know that. And as the worship team comes up this morning, we have a lot to be thankful for, and we want to praise God with our hearts and with our voices. So you sing today with all of your heart. Okay.
Praise God. Sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way from the earth to the cross.
Endures forever. Sing praise. His love. His love endures forever. 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 His love endures forever.
Sing praise.
Good morning, Prescott Valley Bible Church. Hey, let's stand up and say hi to somebody.
God is good all the time. He put a song of praise in this heart of mine.
I think this is a stand-up song.
God is good.
Stand up, everybody.
All the time. Through the darkest night, His light will shine. God is good. God is good. All the time. God is good. All the time. Light will shine. God is good. Yes, God is good all the time.
That's right.
If you're walking through the valley, there are shadows all around. Do not fear. He will guide you. He will keep you safe and sound. He has promised to never leave you or forsake you, and His word is true. God is good all the time. He put a song of praise in His heart and mind. God is good all the time. Through the darkest night, His light will shine. God is good. God is good all the time.
Yes, He is.
We were sinners and so unworthy, still for us He chose to die. He filled us with His Holy Spirit. Now we can stand and testify that His love is everlasting, and His mercies, they will never end. God is good all the time. Put a song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good all the time. Through the darkest night, His light will shine. God is good. God is good all the time.
Yes, He is.
Oh, I may not understand all the plans You have for me. My life is in Your hands, and through the eyes of faith I can clearly see that God is good all the time. He put a song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good all the time. Through the darkest night, His light will shine. God is good. God is good all the time.
Joining us for the first time, thanks for being with us. If you're watching from home for the first time, we're glad you're with us here right now. No matter when you're watching it, right here for us, we're coming up on the Christmas and Thanksgiving time. Thanksgiving is just a few days away, and so I hope everybody's ready for that. And so today's message is really this: Thanksgiving is more than a day. It's a frame of mind. And today I want us to really understand that, because, friends, I have to tell you that when we come into this time of the year, this season, for many people, it's a great joyful time, but then they get tied up in the hustle and bustle of the season and the setting up things and picking out food and doing different things, and we miss the true meaning of the time of the year, the thing that we're supposed to really be doing. For some of you who are watching, it's not the most joyous time of the year. For some of you who are watching, you might be a little bit down during the holidays. You might be a little bit sad. You might find yourself in a place where you're discouraged. I've talked to people before in my life that have said, I'll just be glad when it's over and we can get to the other side of this. Now, that's hard for me to understand, because I'm a big Thanksgiving and Christmas person. I love this time of the year. It's really very special to me. Thinking back to when I was much younger, maybe not much younger, a little younger, we used to have these big Thanksgiving parties. You know, when people would come to our house, my mom would have things set up, and she'd have tables like we have here, long tables. And people would sit at the table. And, you know, people that came together, they hadn't been together all year. You hardly ever see them. And here comes Aunt this person, Uncle that person. Here comes my cousins. Here comes all of these people. And let me tell you something. Prior to doing that, I have to tell you, as a young person, you know, we would have 40, 50 people at the house. And leading up to that time, I can't say I was really joyful. In fact, I would kind of think, I don't even like these people, some of them. I didn't say that, but you know what I mean, right? People think that, like, you know, we're going to have a great time as long as a fight doesn't break out. Because people are together. They hadn't been together in a long time. But you know what's really funny is that we would have this long, long table, and everybody acted like they had assigned seats. They sat in the same seat all the time, every year. My dad was always at the end of the table, and her, and my uncle and his wife, and it would just right, go right down the list. I mean, it would just go right down. Everybody was there. And, you know, we'd sit there, and us kids would go, oh, no. Dad's going to tell that same stupid story again. You know what I mean? You know the story, right? He's going to tell that same story over again. And every time he did it, everybody laughed like it was the first time they ever heard it. And it's like, I could tell these stories. And so they would just go around. They were telling stories of their youth. I wasn't even born yet, but I feel like I was there because I've heard the story so many times I could envision what was going on. But yet, you find yourself in a place where you go, I'm not really too thankful this Thanksgiving. I mean, it's a big mess. There's a lot to do. I had to set up all this stuff. We had to do all of this. And then what happens is a Thanksgiving comes, and there's nobody sitting in the chair. The chair is empty. And nobody's sitting there. And then you begin to learn what Thanksgiving is about. Because as you look around that room, and my dad is not there, and you know, I would have given everything that I owned to hear him tell that same stupid story again, right? And so you begin to start thinking, man, maybe Thanksgiving is more than turkey and stuffing or whatever else you call stuffing. But I'm from the East, so I called it stuffing. Stuffing, mashed potatoes, and pumpkin pie, and all of that stuff. Maybe it's really more than that. Maybe it's not about the food. Maybe it's about the things we should be thankful for when we have them. I was at a store yesterday, and it was a bagel shop. I found a bagel shop. Anybody comes to Phoenix, come see me. We'll go to a bagel shop. It's the best bagel place you could ever think of. And I'm sitting there, and I'm eating a bagel, and this guy is on the phone, and he was just progressively getting angry. And he'd hang up the phone, and he looked over at me because I've got that face. You know, talk to this guy. He's sitting there. And he looked over at me, and he goes, it's my wife's birthday. I asked her what she wanted. She wanted bagels, and she's called me three times telling me, don't get this kind, get that kind, don't get this kind, don't do that. And I want coffee, but I don't want vanilla creamer. I want, you know, and he's telling me this, and he's getting progressively angry as he's telling me this. He says, what am I supposed to do with that? And I said, I want you to thank the Lord that your wife called you on the phone and said those things, because my wife can't call me up. Whew. You would think I slapped him in the face. I kind of did in a nice way. And he goes, you know, you're right. You see, every one of us today, as we look at Psalms, we have a tremendous lesson that you and I can learn when it comes to this Thanksgiving season. Even though we may not have things the way we want it, we may have lost people that we've loved, we may find ourselves in a place where we go, what do I have to be thankful for? And God says, you have a lot to be thankful for. And friends, that's the message today. And so how do you and I get through a time that people battle with for Thanksgiving leading up to Christmas? Let's pray. Well, dear Heavenly Father, as we come together right now, We pray, Lord, that you speak to our hearts, that you give us wisdom, that you help us to understand your truth, and that how we are supposed to be thankful in season, out of season, how we're supposed to be thankful for everything you do in our lives. We're supposed to be thankful for waking up in the morning and for being able to lay our head down at night. So, Father, help us now to see your truth in your word and be with us. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Today's message is really not a downer, you guys. And I want you to know it's really a message of hope. And if you could grab a hold of what we're talking about today, I think it'll change your Thanksgivings. I recently saw a study of people in America. Now get a load of this. Today's lifestyle, people are 99.4% better than any other time in their lives in our world. 99.4% better. But the culture we live in somehow feels like we don't have enough. We live in a society that says, I need more. I want more. That's what I need to make me happy. See, here's what you should know. There's always the newest fashions, right? Ladies, men, you buy fashions, you buy clothes, and the next thing you know, it's on clearance because there's a new style or a new design coming out. I mean, you go to buy a car, and when you go to buy that car, you buy it, and then you find out it's discontinued because there's a new model coming out. And they have all these whiz-bang things. I mean, I've been in cars before that just about drive themselves nowadays, and I'm kind of scared of that, honestly. I bought a computer for church, one that I use to do all of my messages, to do all my videos, everything, and I bought that a few years ago, and let me tell you something, about 6 months after I bought that, oh, that's an old model, there's a new model. It does much more. It does, mine is fine. And I'm glad for it. I hope it runs forever because I know it. I know how it works. See, what happens is people buy more and they become satisfied less because they feel like they've done it too soon or they feel like there was something better. And the truth is, where Thanksgiving is here, we're coming up on Christmas. Can I tell you something about Christmas? People buy into this. And they spend so much money, it'll take them almost the next Thanksgiving to pay off what they spend for Christmas. That's scary. That's scary. You know, I remember giving one of my nephews when he was just a little guy. Now he's a grown man with kids and himself. When he was just a little guy, I remember buying this present for him and giving it to him. And you know what he did? He ripped open the box and he took out the present and he played with the box. And I'm like, it's just the box, play with the present. You know what I mean? And it's one of those things and you go, well, what is this? What is there a lesson in this? Is there something that we should know? Well, so people today, they get in, they buy into this, and sometimes they don't have any money. Or they find themselves in a place where it's really hard to make ends meet, and how can I celebrate Christmas when I don't have any money? Well, Christmas that's coming up is about the birth of our Savior. It's not about the sale at it's not the sale at some store, JCPenney's or something, think of some place. You know what I'm saying, right? So what happens is people find themselves and they get off track and they start going the wrong way. And the next thing you know, they're walking around and they're depressed because they never have enough. They become upset because they're always waiting for something to happen there's something better to come along before they do anything. People find themselves distanced from their family because they work all the time. You ever hear of this? People working all the time in order to have more money to spend on their kids that they don't get to see open up the presents because they're working all the time. Something's very wrong. Something is very, very wrong. Well, in Psalms 33, we're going to see how Psalms 33 and Psalms 32, the end of 32, they kind of go together, but they put a chapter in between there. But one leads into the other. And we're going to see where David had this sin in his life. And it got it up on the rooftop, I think it was, in this story. And then we find out how David walks through this and how he's thankful. Let's go to Psalms 33, verses 4 through 9, and look at what it says. For the word of the Lord is right and true. He is faithful in all he does. The Lord loves righteousness and justice, and the earth is full of his unfailing love. By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made. Their starry host by the breath of his mouth. He gathers the water in the sea into a jars. He puts the deep into storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the people of the world revere him. Verse 9. For he spoke, and it came to be. He commanded, and it stood firm. Friends, we need to be thankful today because of, here's the first point in your notes. The word of the Lord is right and true. He is faithful in all he does. The word of the Lord is right and true. You know, we live in a world that there's not much you could depend on. But here's what I do know. The word of God is something you and I can absolutely depend on. See, the world says to the young people who are watching, people who are out there, if it feels good, do it. The world says that we should go with the flow and anything is okay in moderation. Really? Is that really true? See, the word of the Lord is right and true. By the word of the Lord, we are heavenly made. We've been made for a purpose. You and I, he spoke things into existence. He spoke and it came to be. He commanded and it stood firm. You see, you and I, we can be thankful today because we have a source of truth. And the source of truth is God's word. It is something that we can count on day in and day out. When we don't know what to do, we don't know where to stand, when we don't know how to press forward, let's not make God the last resort. Let's put him first and ask him. Man, I understand how that is because sometimes we grapple with things. Is grapple a good word? Do you guys know what that means? Sometimes we fight with things and we're worried about things and we think about things and then you realize, where's God in this? How come I didn't bring him in the middle of this? You see, people find themselves, and God talks about this, with two choices in life. Every one of us has two choices to make. And the Bible puts it like you have two choices, life or death. And he says, choose life. You and I have two choices to make in our lives when things go, when we're in the middle of stuff, right and wrong. I know this is hard to imagine, but friends, do you know there are things that are wrong? Isn't that okay to say that anymore? Or do we have to say, that there's my right and your right. No, there isn't. There's God's right and every other thing is wrong. There's God's truth and the rest is a lie. Friends, listen, in a world that compromises, that says, you know, there's not absolutes, there are absolute truths. And this Thanksgiving, as you get ready to sit down and have that turkey and eat too much food, I want you to stop for a minute and thank God that we can know the truth, that we can walk in His way. You see, it's God's word that needs to lead us. It's God's promises that we have to stand on. It's God's direction that we have to seek. See, there's a theme here. Thanksgiving is about thanking God for a new day, for another opportunity. See, I'm thankful today because God's word encourages those who are discouraged. Ever been really discouraged? I mean really discouraged. I mean, like, you start crying and you don't know why. Ever do that? Have you ever done that? Friends, if you've never done that, let me tell you something. You think that there's something wrong with you. Something from the other room coming in here. You think that there's something wrong with you. Because you're sitting there and you're happy one second, and the next minute you're bawling your head off. And you're going, what is wrong? What is wrong? See, I'm happy because God's word is convicting. Really? Why would you be happy about that? Because convicting has a purpose. I want you to understand this for a minute. There's a difference between convicting and condemning. Condemning means, I'm done with you, you're out. Convicting means you're making a mistake and you need to turn towards God. And that's what God does for us. He convicts us and He says, Andy, you're kind of going the wrong way. Turn around and come back a little. In a loving way. I'm so thankful for that. He converts those that need converting. You know what's interesting about this room? It's full of people that were lost. Every one of us were lost at one time, and God converted us to being saved for eternity. How can you not be thankful for that? See, everything that's out there, the world that's out there, the things that we've come across, sometimes we want to put labels on them. And the label I want to put on them is that these are God's creations that have been created to bring us more of an abundant life. I was talking to Scott this morning as we were driving up to church. And we were saying, you know what's really interesting? Years ago when my dad was alive, people lived to about 55, 60 years old. Now, people are living in ancient history, you know what I mean? They're living a long time. Don't look at Gene, but you know what I mean? You know, people live a long time. And they go great. And they're doing great. And let me tell you, he's not done yet. I'm so thankful for that. I kid Gene all the time because I love him. And the truth is, here's a guy, he's 88 years old, right? 88 years old. And he drives, he has his moments. But let me tell you something. I'm aspiring to be Gene. I want to be like him. I should be like him when I'm 88 years old. Friends, every one of us has situations in our lives, and we can say, well, this really stinks and this really stinks. Or we can say, thank you, Jesus, that I've got this, that I'm here, that I'm alive, that I've got so much ahead of me, that God, you're not done with me yet, and that you're going to use me. Friends, I thought my life was over. I thought it was over. And God says, I'm not done with you yet. And I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful for that. Friends, today we have a lot to be thankful for. Every one of us. See, what would we do if you and I didn't have Jesus in our lives? I look at the world and I see what's going on out there. And I think, how can you live in the world we live in today with the craziness that's going on and not have Jesus in your life? Friends, let me tell you that. If you're one of those people that are living like that, let me tell you something. You need Jesus, and you need him now. And if you do that, if you accept him, if you bring him into your life, we're not closing, by the way, but if you bring him into your life, here's what I want you to know. You'll be thankful the rest of your life because you have a reason to celebrate. Here's the second thing. We need to be thankful for his work. Man, God is at work. You see God at work all the time. Psalms 33, verses 10 through 11. Look at what it says. The Lord foils the plans of the nations. He thwarts the purposes of the people. But the plan of the Lord stands firm forever. The purpose of his heart throughout all generations. You see, God has a plan, and we are a part of it. And the world has a plan, and it's not the plan God has. And listen, we have to stand on the firm foundation of what God has for us, because God is worthy of our praise. Proverbs 19:21 says this, many are the plans of people in the person's heart, but it is the Lord's purpose that prevails. So today, you and I, we may have our own plans in our heart, but let me tell you something. If it's not lined up with God's plans, we need to change our plans, because God's plans are going to bring an abundant life to our lives. Friends, you and I find ourselves in a place, and we want to talk about all of these things that we feel like we're losing control. We're people who like to have control in our lives, right? I don't want to give my control over to anybody. I don't want anyone telling me what to do. And God says, get out of that. Stop doing that. Let God direct your path. And when it's not the same as the one that you're on, it's not God that's wrong. It's you that's off a little bit. So get back on track. See, God has work to do. He has work for you, and he has work for me to do. And see, the best thing you and I can do is pay attention. We need to pay attention to what's going on around us. Ever have these plans for your life, and then you have these plans, but something keeps stepping in front of them? And you keep doing, you can't go, you can't do this, you can't. Wait a minute, I've got these plans, I've had these plans, and something keeps changing them. Well, don't keep trying it. Maybe there's a message there. Maybe there's something you need to know. Maybe what you're thinking is not what God is thinking. And so stop for a minute and say, Lord, what am I supposed to do? Because God is at work. See, he made us people of choices. And I think he messed up. I think God messed up when he did that. I would rather have just been a person that was made to walk in God's way than to have a choice to walk in God's way. But God didn't create us that way. See, we've all got something to do. We have, you know, my dad, Ron, my dad used to say, Now, Andrew, because then I knew I was in trouble, right? Andrew, he'd say, we could do this the easy way or we could do it the hard way. You make the choice. And do you know what? Sometimes I took the hard way. Even though I had all the warning signs, even though I had the word, even though I was trying to be helped, and somebody was saying to me, look, what you're going to do is going to be bad. You're going to be sorry, and you're going to wonder, how did I get to this mess? God, what are you doing? And God is saying, what are you doing? Because you're going the wrong way. Friends, God has work for us to do. Thank you, Jesus, for that. Because he has it for every one of us. You see, people like to blame God for things, but when someone steals something, when someone is taking drugs, or when people kill one another, and or children are being physically abused, and we want to blame God for that, and God says that none of those things are of me. People have choices to make. What people don't understand is that our choices, whether they're good or bad, don't just affect us. You ever hear anybody ever say, this is my life, it's only going to affect me? Well, can I tell you something? I don't know one young person or older person who made a bad choice and it didn't affect their mom and dad. It didn't affect brothers and sisters. Friends, I was in a class, in this class full of people, and I looked around the room, and here's a daughter, a mother, a father, a brother, and they were there because one of their other sons or brothers took a drug and it killed them. Who did that drug, taking that drug, who did it affect? Just them? It affected everyone around them. Everyone who loves one another. God has a plan and purpose for our lives. And when we decide to go the wrong way, then we find ourselves in this place where we don't know where to turn. And when you do that, turn to God and be thankful that you're able to do that, because God is the one that needs our praise. Remember what I just read in verse 11? The plans of the Lord stand firm, and the purpose of his heart through all generations, through your kids, through your kids' kids. Let me tell you something. The stance that you take today is going to affect your children and your children's children. I've had people say to me before, I don't like to force my kids to go to church, because I want it to be their choice. No, you don't. No, you don't. When it was time for me to go to church as a kid, I'd say, I think I'm going to stay home. And you know what the answer was? No, you're not. When that car starts, you better be in it. Amen to that. Look at what it says in Psalms 33:12. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people he chose for his inheritance. Man. Blessed is the nation that God is the Lord. I still like to believe that America is the nation that has God as the Lord. You see, that's why I could still pull out a bill out of my pocket. Whew, I had one. Do you know what it says on here? In God we trust. Now, some of you are trying to take that off of there. Forget it. Because in God we trust. I better put this back before I lose it. It's going to buy me lunch today. I got a buck. Psalms 33, verses 13 through 19. Look at what it says. From heaven, the Lord looks down and sees all mankind. From his dwelling place, he watches all who live on earth. He who forms the earth of all. Forms the hearts of all, thank you. Who considers everything they do. No king is saved by the size of his army. No warriors escape by his great strength. A horse is a vain hope for deliverance. Despite all the great strength, it cannot save. But the eyes of the Lord are on those who fear him, on those who hope is in his unfailing love, to deliver them from death and keep them alive in famine. Here's the third point in your notes. God is our protector. Man, we need protection. And there is no better protector than God. You see, in verse 13 there that we read through 18, it's pretty clear of that. See, God sees all mankind. It says he watches all who live on the earth. He considers everything we do. He considers all of that. His eyes, the eyes of the Lord are on you. I love that the eyes of the Lord are on us. I'm thankful for that because I need them to be on me. Because sometimes, I don't know about you guys, but my will and his will are a little different. You know? And I have to battle that. I have to battle that a lot. Because, you know, it's easy for me to go, well, you'll be okay with this. And I have to battle. And I do. In verses 16 through 19 that we looked at, we have assurance that God is the protector. It says, no kings, remember we read this just now, can save by the size of his army, the horse. And it's a vain hope for deliverance. A horse is a horse. Of course. Oh, go ahead. You could have said it. I didn't plan it that way, but I heard your voices. I heard everyone say that. Where was I at here? Yeah. But then it says that the eyes of the Lord are on us to protect us, to watch over us, to care for us. Doesn't that make you thankful? I am so thankful for that. See, today we're talking about this, and man, I could be thankful for God's work. I could be thankful for his word that guides us. I could be thankful for his protection. Man, those are things that stand the length of time. And then the question now becomes, how should we thank him? How do you and I thank him for those things and more? And in verse 33, verse 1 through 3 in Psalms 33, it talks about this. Look, it says this, sing joyful to the Lord. We did that this morning. You righteous, sing joyful to the Lord, you righteous. It is fitting for the upright to praise him. We need to praise him every day. In verse 2, praise the Lord with the harp, but make music to him. With the 10-string lyre, it says, sing to him a new song. Play skillfully. Shout for joy. And how do we thank him? By making a joyful noise. I mean, I could just see God smiling when he sees us singing praises to him. Well, Andy, I understand all of that, but what, you don't know my life. You don't know what I'm going through. You don't know the problems I have. Sometimes I just don't feel like praising him. You see, in those moments when I don't feel like praising, I still can praise God for who He is. I can praise Him with music. I can praise Him with song. I can sing shouts for joy. You know, don't judge me. I know it's not Thanksgiving yet, but I just decorated my whole inside of my house for Christmas. And I looked at and I went, praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus, it's 2023 and I'm still standing here. And I'm saying, look at what you've done. See, sometimes you might find yourself in a place where you go, I don't feel so joyful. And maybe you just have to be looking a little harder. I see countries, and we hear about countries where people are rising up against each other. I see what's happening in Israel. I see what Russia is doing, so be ready to block us, Russia. I see what Russia's doing in the Ukraine, and I see those things, and I go, thank you, Jesus, that I'm here and not there. Thank you, Lord, that as a country, you've made us be someone who helps people who are attacked and not people who are attacked. You see, we have so much in our lives to thank God for. So we need to be about praise. As a church, we need to be about praise, but individually, we need to be about praise. And so let me give you a few thoughts. First, one of them is here. We need to praise Him musically. We need to praise Him musically. I've said this before, but my mother-in-law used to live with us for a while, for about 10 years. And we had this rocking chair that we bought her in the front room. And she'd sit on this rocking chair, and it would start here, and it would be up there in about an hour because she would rock forward to get all the way up there. And she would sing, this is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Now, that wasn't good, but she was really bad. She was really a bad singer. But you know what? If you saw her face and you heard her heart, God was going, that's the most beautiful voice I've ever heard. Because she sang it with her heart. And I'd walk in that house and I'd go, I'd thank Jesus, but I would go like this. Oh, Jesus. Help me a little bit here. And then I'd look at her and it would bring a smile to my face. Because this little old lady who was 3'11", you know, just little woman, that was probably 3 feet wide. And she was just the sweetest, most loving heart woman you ever want to meet. And she was thankful for everything, you know. Valentine's Day would come and I'd buy my wife a present for Valentine's Day. And I always bought her a box of candy. A little crummy box of candy. You know, like a $7.99 Walgreens box of candy that I got for $6.99 because Peaches got me a discount. And I would bring it to her and give it to her. And you know, she would act like I gave her $1 million. Friends, I want you to know as we start thinking about Christmas, and that's where we're going next. Don't look at a gift and go, it's not so great. Look at a gift and go, I see the heart that gave it to me. See, friends, that's what Thanksgiving is about. That's what joy is about. Look at Psalms 33, verse 3. Sing to Him a new song. Play skillfully. Shout for joy. Friends, every week we come together and we sing praises to God, and we do that. And man, I hope you do it full-heartedly, and I hope you sing to God and not to everyone else around. Honestly, folks, I don't care how you sound. I just care that you're singing to God. That's the thing that's important. So we praise him skillfully. And then it says that we need to pray for him, or we need to praise him joyfully, with great joy in our hearts. It's not about how good you are at what you do. It's about the praise that you lift up to him. It's about the joy in your heart, because we should be so overwhelmingly, can't say that word, joyful, because God is with us. Psalms 33, 20 through 22, here's what it says. We wait in hope for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. In him our hearts rejoice, for we trust in his holy name. May your unfailing love be with us, Lord. Lord, even as we put our hope in you. Friends, today as we wrap down here, I pray that your Thanksgiving this year is more than being thankful for the food on the table, although we should be thankful for that. More than the people that are coming to your place. We should be thankful for that. But I pray today that your Thanksgiving surrounds who God is, what he has done in our lives, and that we can know him better every day. For that, we should be very thankful. Maybe you're watching from home today. Maybe you've never asked Jesus to be the Lord of your life. Friends, can I tell you, make this the greatest Thanksgiving ever, because by accepting him, you will have a real reason to be thankful for this Thanksgiving. I want to invite you to pray with me. If you'll ask him to come in, the Bible says he will. And so everyone, if you will all repeat after me, and wherever it is you're watching from, if you're watching from home, God hears your voice right there, right where you're at. And you could participate in this with us. Will you do that? Let's pray. Dear Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Forgive me of my sins. I repent of my sins. I accept you now as my personal Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. As the worship team comes up to sing this last song, I want to invite you here. If you need prayer this morning, you go to the back, and Ron and Robert, if you'll pray with people back there. And for those of you at home, if you need prayer today, I want to invite you to write into us and let us know, and we will be praying for you. And so you please do that.
to answer his call. Bring all of your fears, bring all of your sins, bring all of the doubts that you hold within. Jesus is waiting for you. Bring it all. Bring it all. Bring it all. Oh. Bring all of the wrongs that have been done to you. Bring all the wrongs that you have done to you. Bring them all to the one with power to change. Bring all of your debts, bring all that you owe, bring all of the heartaches that you've ever known. Bring it all to the one, the one.
Well, dear Lord, we leave this place today thanking you for who you are, for your word that guides us, for your spirit that leads us, for your protection over our lives. We thank you, Father, that we know that you watch us every moment of our lives. And so, Father, we pray as your people, as we praise you and thank you for this time, we thank you, Lord, for everything that's in our lives. For the good and the bad, we praise you, Lord, that even in our bad times, that we can trust in you and that you will see us through and teach us through those things. So, Lord, we thank you now for this place. I thank you for these people. I thank you for all those who watch from home. And we just pray, Lord, your blessings upon every single one of us and each person here. And Lord, thank you for who you are. Yes. Happy Thanksgiving, everyone. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks for being here.